With much of the government shut down at least through Christmas, with Defense Chief Jim Mattis leaving, with U.S. troops pulling out of Syria, with stock market sharply declining, the media are now pushing this narrative. As described by the Washington Post, Trump single-handedly propelled the U.S. government into crisis and set markets tumbling. Politico says Trump allies are privately expressing new levels of concern about the president's erratic behavior. Some pundits on the right joined in the criticism when the president agreed to a stopgap funding compromise with zero money from the wall. And under pressure from House conservatives, Trump then vowed not to sign any bill without that funding, leading to this weekend's partial shutdown. Joining us now to analyze the coverage, Molly Hemingway, senior editor at The Federalist and a Fox News contributor. Sarah Fisher, media reporter for Axios. And Philippe Reines, a former State Department official under Hillary Clinton. Molly, some stories are saying we have a partial government shutdown because Donald Trump was cowed and coerced by conservative commentators on Fox, by Rush Limbaugh, by Ann Coulter, who hammered him for initially going along with that stopgap funding bill that wouldn't have funded the wall at all.
Well, and that's because Donald Trump himself said that he believed border security was important enough that if it weren't funded, if this wall weren't funded, he would take credit for a government shutdown. And then it sounded like maybe there was some backtracking on that. So absolutely conservative media pushed back because they wanted to make sure that he wasn't backtracking. And here we are. So it's a good reflection that the people's sentiment was somehow expressed in the media, either through conservative media or otherwise.
Interesting. So, Philippe, it's not every week that Fox and Friends, the president's favorite show, criticizes Trump, in this case on both issues, Syria, which we'll get to, and the wall and the shutdown maneuvering. Is it that certain pundits on the right are so all-powerful, or are they seen as reflecting the views of Trump's base, which, as we know, are very important to him?
Well, from my perspective, as a Democrat who comes into the, you know, belly of the beast pretty often, it seems to me that what triggers Republican-on-Republican violence is usually immigration. And I think the problem is that Molly just touched on is that the president is not hardcore believer in much of anything to the extent that he has no problem coming off these things. So it happened with DACA, where you saw another one of these meetings where
you compromise and then we don't
compromise. And don't. And you see the Republicans in the room are wincing. And you see it with Chuck and Nancy last week. And I think it brings up a larger, it brings up two. One is the conservative, but also brings that these are self-inflicted wounds. The president is so used to wanting cameras right. that he brings them into times that there shouldn't be cameras.
And speaking of Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi, and Molly, you just referenced this. Question for you, Sarah. I want to play the soundbite that is being endlessly replayed by the media of that meeting less than 2 weeks ago.
I am proud to shut down the government for border security, Chuck. I will take the mantle. I will be the one to shut it down. I'm not going to blame you for it.
So now that the president is blaming the Democrats for the shutdown, are the media kind of enjoying him being boxed in by his earlier words and the current partisan battle?
That's right, with some even comparing this to George H.W. Bush's read my lips, no new taxes. When you verbally promise something to the American people with cameras involved, you have to be ready for any kind of pushback when you go back from your word. And that's exactly what Donald Trump is facing right now with his base and conservative members of the media saying, wait a minute, that's not what you just did and said last week.
The withdrawal of the 2,000 troops from Syria was portrayed in the press as kind of a shocker, but Trump did say during the campaign and since that, you know, he is opposed to extended or endless military entanglements overseas. Is he up against essentially a media establishment that favors military intervention?
Absolutely. And we saw this. I mean, it's actually kind of a crisis. When you're seeing all these stories about pulling back our troop presence in Syria, you're getting nothing but quotes from people who think that we should have perpetual presence in Syria. Now, that is true that a lot of people in the foreign policy establishment all think the same way. They all supported, you know, lengthy intervention in Iraq and Afghanistan, which is on 17 years now.
Yes.
And they are for, now that we've accomplished our stated mission in Syria, they're trying to change the stated mission from military defeat of ISIS into enduring defeat of ISIS, which is something that could mean that we will be there for 17 years. So you're not getting a lot of diversity of viewpoint, and it's a serious problem, and it's something that media people need to make sure they're getting that viewpoint from people who don't believe in endless intervention in Syria.
And, you know, the president justified this by saying ISIS has been defeated or largely defeated. Seems to me liberals have to be restrained on this because Barack Obama, you worked in that administration, pulled out of Iraq, got hammered by the right for it, and he also, in a way, shared Donald Trump's aversion to endless war in these far-flung places.
I don't think this is as high-minded of a debate about where the U.S. should be deployed. I think this is more simply about First of all, it's congressional Republicans, which is basically Donald Trump's firewall, that he has on occasion basically dared to leave him, first with Charlottesville, then with now with this, but with the Saudi killing. He is leaving them no choice but to criticize him. I don't think that's an intervention or non-intervention thing. It is, don't trifle with the people who are doing your bidding, who have your back.
By that logic, he's also leaving certain conservative commentators with no choice, who believe in differently than he does on this.
I actually think this, that one of the problems we've seen in media coverage has been this perception that only that Republicans only disagree with him. You have multiple senators who are supporting him, including Senator Mike Lee and Senators Rand Paul. You have people on both sides of the aisle who do not believe that we should have this perpetual presence.
So is it that the press is playing up the Lindsey Grahams and Bob Corkers who are denouncing Trump?
But even more than that, only 18% of Americans last year supported having troops in Syria. And Tim Kaine, my senator from Virginia, has been trying to get a new resolution passed to support this endless situation in Syria, and he's had no success. So I think this is a false narrative that's being perpetuated.
But Lindsey Graham said this is a stain on his presidency.
Lindsey Graham has never found a country he doesn't want to.
Lindsey Graham golfs with the president. Sure. He is his biggest defender on Mueller. These are significant things. And there's a difference between Congress and the media.
Sorry, Sarah. Let me move on from Lindsey Graham to Jim Mattis.
Yes.
Because, look, widely respected, his leaving is a very big story. But is the press going a little overboard in portraying him as the last man standing between Donald Trump and the collapse of the Western alliance?
Of course. I mean, we have a large defense department. We have a large defense infrastructure. However, he was viewed as one of the biggest sounding boards and one of the most fundamental rocks when it comes to foreign policy. And so him leaving does scare a lot of people. Going back to your point, though, about media and how they're taking a look at this, you know, I was watching CNN this morning. They had Bob Corker on and they had Rand Paul on. I think that we have to make sure that we're watching each individual show and taking into account which views they put on. It's not always so one-sided.
And just one other thing I want to mention. Not all the media coverage has been bad. I think it was a CNN story or somewhere where I read that 8 months ago, Donald Trump told General Mattis, we need to be out of Syria within 6 months. 8 months ago. So learning some of the context of this situation, Trump, who has been for years saying we need to get out of Syria.
I want to take a look at the bigger picture. I didn't know about the 18% supporting remaining in Syria. Things are pretty volatile. It's been a pretty rough week. Washington's pretty rattled. New York is rattled. What about the media just making this all one big bowl of Trumpian chaos? I'm watching the banners on CNN and MSNBC, and they're all like, shutdown looms as Mattis resigns as stock market tanks, or stock market tanks as Mattis resigns as shutdown looms. And CNN's favorite is Trump tailspin. What do you make of it's all Trump?
With the stock market, the idea that the Fed's action this week doesn't play a role in that is
raising interest rates.
Even when you take the issue on the shutdown, yes, it is true that Donald Trump is forcing this issue. It's also true that it's been forced by inaction among both parties, both houses, and this is something that you can that by noticing it doesn't mean you're the cause of the problem. By saying we finally have to deal with it doesn't mean you're the cause of the problem. It just means you're saying this has to get done.
Philippe, is the coverage of the Syrian pullout influenced by the fact that, essentially Trump style, he did this against the advice of many White House aides, he overruled Mattis, he didn't tell his congressional allies, he didn't tell allies in foreign capitals, and so does that add to the media sense of alarm?
I think when you couple Syria with the firing of Mattis, because they really are the same thing, you have this dynamic that I don't subscribe to, that Jim Mattis was some kind of like blankie where it made everyone feel better at night, and it shouldn't have. And I think there's some psychology going on.
What, four-star general who believes in the defense alliances?
Sure. Two weeks ago, he went up to the Senate Intelligence Committee and said there was no connection between the killing and their intelligence.
Well, I'm not saying you have to agree with everything Mattis does.
No, but I'm saying that to have vested so much in him as this last line of defense against Trump, I think is more about the people saying that than the reality of it.
Do the media, Sarah, reflect the foreign policy establishment's view on many of these issues? We saw this, Molly alluded to this, Afghanistan, Iraq, now Syria, that more military intervention, more troops is better, it's a good fight against terrorism, and less reflecting the views maybe of many Trump supporters, which is why are we spending American tax dollars to constantly be in these places for decades?
I think absolutely. When you bring on tons of foreign policy experts to talk about what the implications are for diplomacy for us in doing something like that, but you're not bringing on moms and dads of people who are waiting for their kids to come home, I do think it does skew the coverage in that bit to
Well, not just that, but there are many foreign policy leaders who actually do support this idea, and you want to bring in those voices as well as average Americans.
Yes, and to your point, though,
but including Congress.
Yeah, but there are people from Congress.
There are people in Congress who also don't believe
they were
should be in.
But they were all taken by surprise.
And, if they wanted to be there, they could very easily pass a resolution saying we should be there. And
but if you're
going to
criticize Barack Obama for sort of just putting us in there and not having enough of a discussion about it, you can't say that Donald Trump had an adequate discussion about pulling out. It's not as simple as keeping a campaign promise.
To get to a break, this debate is not over by any means.